You got me, huh? I want to solicit y'all to please pray for us. I know it's not like you don't have anything to pray for, but if it comes to your mind, pray for Patty and I for our strength. We're running pretty fast and hard right now, so just trying to do a lot of things, so juggle a lot of things. So we appreciate it. I know the grace is there. I feel the grace of the Lord. See, it's always there. When you're moving in the Lord, there's a grace there to do what He asks you to do. He never overloads you. Well, I'm going to continue down this line of thought wherein that I've moved a few weeks ago, and that it has to do with Jesus and the majesty of Jesus and trying to bring a enlarged mental capacity to embrace the magnificence of our Lord and the atonement, and bring it into a greater depth and clarity in, as it relates to the new covenant. So I've spoke quite a bit lately, I feel like I have, on the commandments of the Lord. But I wanted to speak again down the lines of the 5th and 6th and 7th chapter of Matthew again. It's those scriptures are just so real and so important and so potent for a new covenant understanding, especially from the Gospels, that and they lay a groundwork that I think every Christian has a need to spend time there meditating on these chapters and familiarizing themselves with what it is that Christ is really saying to His disciples here. And I've hit all over them. I've spoke about them. I've talked about Moses' law from them. I've spoke about the law of Jesus. I've spoke about how He owns the old covenant and how He's given us the new commandments and the et cetera, and touched on these scriptures. But I don't know that I've stopped ever and just done a little bit of a summary from a certain perspective on the way that Jesus spoke this day on the Sermon on the Mount. I don't know that we've really got the picture or explored it very much, and this certainly is not in any great depth. It's just thoughts that hopefully carry concepts of a bigger picture into your minds. And again, it's about Christ. It's about what He's done, what He's doing, and creating in us a larger capacity to embrace the significance of what He's done. So I don't know what you would title this again, except maybe the qualifications for the inheritance of the kingdom of heavens. So I've said these every time that you can read heaven in the book of Matthew, it's actually in the Greek, it's plural. So this Sermon on the Mount gives us these qualifications for the inheritance of the kingdom of heavens. This, as we know in this group, we have grown to know that this is a mystery. It's the mystery of the kingdom of heavens that Christ mentions in the first part of chapter 13. And he's in that chapter disclosing more of the significance of the kingdom of heavens. And he's also speaking out in terms of Israel has rejected themselves. They have been excluded from. By the 13th chapter of Matthew, the Lord had taken from Israel the promise of the kingdom of heavens. Here it's still open, but somewhere along the way, and I think the 12th chapter of Matthew had a great deal to do with the decision of the Lord, and as he speaks in the 13th chapter, which has, in the 12th chapter, it speaks in terms of I don't know if you could call it apostasy, but it is a sort of a stepping aside and a accusing by the leadership of Israel Christ of being possessed by the devil, and those works that he does in were they declared by the power of Beelzebub. I think this was the crowning blow to the leadership of Israel in their excluding themselves from Christ's mysterious kingdom of heavens. This mysterious kingdom of heavens ministry teaching is hidden in today's modern Christendom. It's hardly known. You could ask somebody, what's the mystery of the kingdom of heavens? And, you know, there'd maybe be some ethereal, but, you know, enigmatic kind of understanding saying it's God in heaven and it's where we're going, something like that. But the significance and the meaningfulness of what Christ was presenting as a part of the inheritance to Israel has been lost to the church. So I have made it my, I don't know, I'd say I've made it my quest or my job to reveal as much as this small voice can the significance of this ministry of the mystery of the kingdom of heavens. Restore it to those that have ears to hear, because it is vital. It is freeing, it is exciting, it's inspiring, it's incentivizing, and if it's not a part of your Christian theology, you are suffering a great deal of loss, as it is something that has to be made aware of. The Lord made his disciples aware of it. The apostles made their disciples aware of it, and made it the vanguard of their ministries. So it has significance. The fifth chapter and sixth chapter and seventh chapter of Matthew has significance in exploring and in exposing the meanings of the mysteries of the kingdom of heaven. And in these three chapters, we find Christ qualifies those that will be found worthy to inherit this mysterious kingdom of heavens. So the Sermon on the Mount is to regenerated believers. It's not to Israel. It's not to the unsaved. It is to the regenerated, born-again believer. Chapter 5, verse 1, and seeing the multitudes, he went up into a mountain, and when he was set, his disciples came unto him. And then he opened his mouth, and he taught them. So it's an instruction. It is instruction on. It is not an instruction on how to receive eternal life. All these had already received eternal life, but how to qualify for this kingdom, that this kingdom that is to be set up by Jesus upon his return. This is real. Christ is real. His kingdom is real. He is coming. We will soon find it out. What we're living in now is a facade. It's unreal. The reality is coming. This is just a vapor. Your life is just a vapor. It's not reality. It's not what you think it is. You know, whatever you're about is not what you are about. Wake up. Come on now. Wake up. These are the realities. You are here today because God has appointed you to be here. You're not here by accident. The Lord directed your steps here, whether you know it or not. He has a word for you. Hear it. Heed it. Put it into practical use. There's nothing here too difficult for you. It's not over your head, and it's not under your feet. is right there in your face. God expects you to hear and to heed. And you just have to forgive the voice he uses, because that's just all he's got up here. So understand that there's this reality behind us, this that we can't see, that God is looking to qualify for him sons that will inherit a kingdom of ruling and reigning in the heavenly realm with Jesus Christ upon his return. That's the reality. That's what you're about. That's your entire life, whether you know it or not. If you don't know it, you just miss it. That's all. Most likely. These things you don't stumble into. Godliness is not just something that's natural. Ungodliness is natural. Just separate yourself from these things and God and the Word and see what happens. It don't take long and the leaven sets in, coldness sets in, wickedness sets in, and you are a part of the world. These things require work and effort and discipline every day, every day, every day until the day you die. And it's exceedingly, abundantly above anything that you could want in this world. The reward, the goals that Christ has set before us is amazing. And it's amazing that we are so blind to them and they're so unreal to us. So we need to stop mentally assenting and daily fight the good fight of faith. Now these verses that I'm going to speak to you about in the 5th and 6th and 7th chapter are qualifications for the inheritance of the kingdom of heaven. Qualifications, qualifications. Christ is giving qualifications. These things you will need to introduce into your life if you are going to qualify for the kingdom of heavens. Not going to happen unless you do it. And there's three particular subjects I find in these three verses or three chapters, 5, 6, and 7. And what I find is the first part here, chapter 5 and the first 10, 12 verses are about the blessings or what's called the Beatitudes. Which is, I think, is some excellence of blessings. Whatever Beatitudes means, it does mean blessings. So these first verses are about blessings. And generally when they Christendom, ministers, they minister in this chapter on the blessings. And that's just about all you'll hear from the church, from Christendom. And then secondarily, just a few verses that are dedicated to what's called the similitudes. The similitudes in the dictionary, I looked it up, that is, it's a quality of being similar. So the similitudes are about being like Christ, right? The similitudes are just real quick and fast. Christ touches on them as salt and light. And those are in verses 13, 14, 15, 16. 13 through 16. And then finally, there are the longest section, which is the remainder of the chapters, is the commandments of Jesus. And the commandments of Jesus are referred to by Paul in Galatians 6:2 as the law of Christ. So the law of Christ I've spoke, I think, a few times lately about, to some degree anyway, and I know in times past often. And I feel compelled to do it again. And if I had time today, I would have done a sermon on all three of these subjects that I find in these three chapters. I would take the time, and at 8 o'clock tonight, I would finish. If I was in India, that's exactly the lesson I would have today. These three subjects that are in these three chapters are all significant. They all run together. They're all part one another. We take them apart. We take a verse and apply it over here to something totally out of context. But when you put them all in context and you look at the Lord's Sermon on the Mount, it's just a Sermon on the Mount. He took the time to minister these things. And you don't come and take one of the things and go over here and apply it over here to something that's totally irrelevant to what he was saying. But we do that. And sometimes it's taken out and applied to relevant. Bang. But We don't have that kind of time, so I decided I would just speak to the blessings. And you thought, well, hurrah. Well, not really. Because I can find accountability in this too, you know, the blessings. I would say it's with an imprecation. One must first understand the law of God as opposed to the law of Christ. So if I have done nothing, I have spoke much on the difference between the law of God, you know, given by Moses, and the law of Christ. I've spoken often about these two things. So first, you at least have to have a cursory understanding of the law of Christ. I think most in here have a understanding of that. Jesus Christ filled the law of God given by Moses with meaning. To this, some people find an insult in that. That sounds as if I just done away with the law of Moses. I just got rid of it. I just stomped it under my feet, kicked it to the curb. Get out of here. Don't want nothing more to do with you. That is not what I mean when I say Christ has fulfilled the law of Moses. And as most of you in here know, that is not what I'm saying. It is, as I said before, I thought the best example I've come up with so far, it is as gravity. It is gravity. You don't replace gravity. You don't get rid of gravity by building an airplane. You get in an airplane, you supersede the law of gravity. Gravity's still in effect. Just run out of fuel and see what happens. So I'm not getting rid of gravity here. I'm just simply saying Christ is the airplane. Christ has superseded the law, and as long as we're in the airplane with fuel, we're going to be above the law of Moses. We'll be above it, superseding it with the law, another law, the law of spirit of life in Christ Jesus. Just as you supersede the law of gravity with the law of lift, we are superseding the law of Moses with the law of the spirit of life in Christ Jesus. Are you with me? Okay. I don't want to get into that sermon, but I can't help myself. So we first know that Jesus Christ filled the law of God with meaning. That is to say, once a person receives Him, Jesus Christ, who filled that law with meaning, he is placed now under the law of Christ. If you're in Christ, that means you're in covenant. If you're in covenant, that's not a contract, right? Covenant is to the death. The contract is till I change my mind and want to do something different. I divorce you, you stink, whatever. But a covenant is to the death. A covenant is irrevocable. You can't stop a covenant. Once you enter into a covenant, there's no backing off of it, and there's no getting out of it. So you're in covenant. So you're under the law of Christ in covenant. I don't know. I think husbands and wives got to get a good picture of that, especially after they go through a bunch of stuff, you know, this and that, the continued stuff. They realize it's not a contract, or they had a long since done something different. They know it's a covenant, and they forgive, and they let the Lord use the other one as an adversary, and then he lets the other one be a comforter. It's interesting, the dynamic. It's a lot like the Lord. So we're in a covenant with the Lord. I don't care if you're young and you're going to get old, you're never going to get out of covenant. Now, you may get out of fellowship, but you're never going to get out of covenant. You never divorce the Lord. You can't divorce the Lord. If you ever enter into covenant with Him, that's eternal. The thing is that you lose all the benefits of the blessings. You lose all the benefits of what you could have had if you'd have remained in fellowship and covenant. Just as if I decided I didn't want to be with Patty no more, and I just went off to myself, I'd lose the benefits of Patty. I'd lose that fellowship. And so it is. And so it is that we have entered into this covenant, and there's no getting out of it, and the covenant has responsibilities. How many know that? It's not one-sided. Covenant is not one-sided. Marriage is not one-sided. Covenant is not one-sided. It takes both parties or all parties. when they entered in a covenant, to fulfill a covenant. See, Patty got up and left. She heard enough of this. She's had enough of me. At least for today. So he is placed after you receive Christ and you enter into covenant with him, you've been placed under the law of Christ. You're no longer in gravity. You're not subject to gravity. You're subject to the airplane. You're in the airplane. You're under the law of Christ. Now these three chapters are addressed to those who are his. These are disciples. And they're reborn again. They're regenerated. And so they're no longer under the law of Moses, but under the law of Christ, the keepers of which are promised a glorious inheritance in the kingdom of heavens. Verse 9 says, theirs is the kingdom of heavens. And you'll find it throughout Matthew, Mark, Luke, John, and the rest of the Bible. But I'm hoping that you have some understanding that the kingdom of heavens is a real thing. It's not nebulous as, you know, a place where the angels are, and that's where we're going, and we're going to be in the presence of God, and we do that when we die. None of that's true. None of that's correct. None of it's scriptural. This kingdom of heavens has to do with Christ ruling and reigning over and in the earth. And these promises are addressed to those who would be a part of the kingdom of heavens. So it has to be that you would be in covenant with him. You could not be addressed and have the word of encouragement in the covenant if you weren't in covenant. So the believers who keep these, his law, his words, and teach others to keep them will be called great or have a great reward in the kingdom of heavens. The believers who break only the least of these commandments and teach others to do so will be called the least in the kingdoms, least of all. And when we speak in terms of teaching and doing the word, we're talking about the words of Christ. This is not a subject addressed to keeping the law of Moses. You keep the law of Moses, if you do that, you'll be great in the kingdom. Or if you don't keep the law of Moses, you'll be least in the kingdom. That is a misapplication. It's a misnomer. It's a messianic mess up. The reality is this is a word by Christ as it relates to keeping his words, keeping covenant with him, doing what he says. And it's about his kingdoms. So you either be little or great in that kingdom. You have great reward or little reward. I would say that the word suggests that we'll all be in a kingdom per se, the kingdom of God. All those that are eternally born again, have eternal life and entered into a covenant with Christ, will in the end be in the kingdom of God. But there's two things that transpire before that. First of all, your life. Second of all, a millennium, 1,000 years. Now, your life is going to dictate to you how you live your life here is what's going to, in covenant with Christ, is going to dictate as to how you are in the millennium. Then that you are dictated to as your presence and your reward or lack of reward in the millennial period also has an influence upon the kingdom of God in eternity. It isn't a democracy. It never has been a democracy. It never will be a democracy. It's God's way or the highway. You understand what I'm saying? He's a dictator. God is a dictator. Now, he's a benevolent dictator, but he's a dictator, and we're not voting. And it's not a democracy. And according to God's rule, there's different levels. And levels have to do with faithfulness and love and zeal and desire and obedience and the different characteristics of a Christ-like or a God-like being has more authority more glory in the kingdom of God. Now, you don't like it. That's just the way it is. It's not a matter of liking or not liking. It's a matter of understanding and believing and knowing. So this is the way God is. You're not going to be just like Paul. I'm not going to be just like Paul. I'm not going to have the same things that Paul has. I'm not going to have the same things David or Abraham has. These are men that have proven through life. David, faithful men, godly men, who suffered with Christ, who suffered with God, brought glory to God. And you know, when I compare myself to these men, I have done nothing. Just insignificant. So it is in God's mind that they would be great in the kingdom. The apostles, all 12 of them, are appointed thrones. They're great in the kingdom of Christ. They were with him in his sufferings, and they suffered faithfully all of their lives till their death. They will have a greater place in the kingdom of heavens than you or I. Or unless, I'll say I. Unless you guys do something outstanding in the rest of your lives, you know, I can't say, you know. But I'm just trying to make a point, is that these blessings are contingent. And they're according to our will. I know that God is not, he's not narrowing or making a lesser opportunity for you to receive less than anyone. He's not put you in a box and say, well, this is an inferior being here. He can't excel to be nothing. God has not done that. God has given us the capacity to capacitate. And we can if we will. And that's our issue. One of the issues. One of the issues is, unfortunately, we have too much. When you have too much, you capacitate so little. When you have nothing is when you begin to capacitate. And we're so unwilling to give up anything to get anything. We're quite satisfied with where we're at, generally speaking. And I pray for us all that we learn a different and better way to proceed in our spiritual walk. So these three chapters have to do with these three subjects. And there's certain key thoughts that I'd like for you to keep in mind, because I haven't time to talk on all three of the subjects, but I would like to summarize all three of the subjects and all three of the chapters by just simply saying, in this Sermon on the Mount, there's the qualifying for the kingdom of heaven's inheritance as an underlining theme of all three chapters. In addition, there's the law and grace dispensations across the board here in these three chapters. The one stopping with John and the one beginning with John. In other words, the law was up until John. And then after John, it was a pressing into the kingdom. And so there is this new law, this new dispensation that's coming into being that Christ is ministering and fulfills. He fills it with meaning at the cross. And then in these three chapters, there the spiritual growth is required to inherit this kingdom. There's spiritual growth required to inherit the kingdom of heavens. And then seek first this kingdom of God and his righteousness is a theme throughout these three chapters. Seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness. That's the theme there. And then the way and the gate are narrow. The way and the gate into the kingdom of heavens is narrow and restricted and must be taken by force. That's also a theme of these three chapters. And then not all who call Jesus Lord will inherit the kingdom of heavens. And that we know, most of us have read the scripture often in the seventh chapter of not all that call me Lord, right? So those themes are in these three chapters, and we're only going to speak about the first part of chapter 5. But sandwiched right in the heart of this sermon in the sixth chapter is verses 9 through 13 is the Lord's Prayer. Right in the middle of this discourse, it is the Lord interjects how that we should pray. And I would ask the question, and I'm going to read it just quickly. It's everybody's familiar with it, but the Lord said, "After this manner, therefore, pray ye, our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name." Here's our declaration, you know, the Lord God is our Father. He's in heaven. He's not here, but he's in heaven. His name should be hallowed, and we can hallow it. "Thy kingdom come" is a promise of something that will happen, and we're giving notice, and we're considering that in our prayer. "Your kingdom is coming. Thy will be done on earth." It will, as it is right now in heaven. Give us this day. We are living here on this earth. Give us our day. We need bread. We need sustenance. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts. We're going to develop a lot of debts, especially to you. And we need your forgiveness, but we need to forgive others their debts. The Lord says, this is the way you should pray. If you want forgiveness from the Father, extend it. "And lead us not into temptation." How quickly we could be led into temptation if the Lord just allowed circumstances. Just allowed circumstances. That's all you have to do. All the Lord would have to do is just kind of glance to the left and we'd be in trouble. If his eyes aren't over you and in you, you're going to be in temptations, and we're talking sore temptation, aren't we? We're not talking about just natural daily temptation. We're praying about, God, keep us from the devil's temptation. Deliver us from the devil's evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. So right there in the middle of all of this discourse, we find this, the Lord alludes to prayer as he's speaking to his disciples and say, here's how you fulfill or accomplish that I'm trying to teach you. It isn't going to be done in yourself, but you need to get the Father involved. You need to pray. You need to get him involved with your walk, with your life. You need to put this character into your life. You need to incorporate this character into your life, forgiving. You need to pray that you be led not into temptation. Nothing stronger than that can keep us from the temptations of this day and deliver us from evil. So I understand that that was the Lord. It wasn't at random. It wasn't just a fleeting thought that had no connection. It was connected with all that he's saying in these three chapters as the means by which you might accomplish these things. You're not going to accomplish these things that he's asking us of us without prayer. And that's what I say there. What can be said about prayer that will cause us to see its vital importance? What can be said about prayer that we could see its vital importance? The devil, if he attacks anything, he attacks prayer. It does no good. You've said that before. Whatever his deal is, he attacks prayer continually, often, every time you want to pray. He's got something to say about it. Why? Because it is vitally important. Look up the word prayer in your Bible and read every verse that has anything to do with prayer. And you'll see how important prayer is. You just read the reference. Just get your concordance out and look under the word prayer and pray and find them and read every one of them. Just read the verse. My goodness, we will have a newfound emphasis on prayer. And I'm probably going to teach on prayer shortly as I feel the need. You know, I get off into all of these things, you know, that titillate our minds, and they do propel us in the spirit, but the basics sometimes I just get away from, and I have to come back and say, listen, prayer, so simple, intercession, praying, seeking God, crying out, moaning, groaning, whoa, all these things are so essential to us being successful about what it is that Christ calls us to and about qualifying for the kingdom of heavens. Not going to do it without prayer. You are not going to be successful in qualifying for the kingdom of heavens without incorporating prayer into your life. Whatever that means, you know, I'm not sure. You know, there's different kinds of prayer, all kinds of prayer. And we need to incorporate that into our walk to accomplish these things. So All these things, spiritual, all things spiritual begin and are perpetuated in prayer. I just keep praying. I have seen some things not manifest for 30 and 40 years, and I have not stopped praying. I keep praying the same prayer I was praying 40 years ago because it hadn't manifest. But I have not stopped, nor will I stop. It either I'll die or it'll manifest. But it ain't going to be because I stopped praying. You can't expect things to happen overnight. There's a lot of things that got to change to bring about your answer to your prayer. There's a lot of dynamics. And if Daniel had to pray 21 days with fasting and eating no good food at all, just to get an answer from God about the future of his people, how much prayer you got to pray? If he has to pray like that, well, we expect to just throw a prayer at God one time and then him to do it. It doesn't work that way, and we're foolish to think that way. Prayer is how we perpetuate these things. This is how we'll bring to pass our own qualifying for the inheritance of the kingdom of heaven. It's through prayer. Here the Lord says, pray. Pray what? What are you talking about, Mike? Lead us not into temptation. Or you think you're going to qualify for the kingdom of heavens to rule and reign in it without praying, lead us not into temptation? Lead me not into temptation? Do you think you're going to qualify? I don't need that. Thank you. I don't need that. I don't need that. I don't need keep me from evil. I don't need that prayer. I'm good. I'm good without that. That is not right. And that's the way we act. And we don't think that way. We don't think, no, I don't need the prayer of keeping. But we don't do it. So it's the same thing. We don't need it. We have somehow been duped into thinking that we don't need to pray, lead us not into temptation. I'm strong enough. I'm not going to do that. I quit smoking and I'm not going to smoke again. I quit drinking. I'm not going to drink again. I quit whatever. I'm not going to do it again. And if I do, grace is there. That's kind of where we're thinking. We aren't articulating that, but that's what we're doing. We're saying to the Lord, I don't need to pray, lead me not into temptation, because in reality, I know what the temptations are, and I'm going to do them whether I'm led into them or not, so I don't need to pray that prayer. You don't want to get real. I mean, God knows that's our heart. We're not praying for him not to lead us into temptation because we've already set our heart to be tempted and do it. Well, there's the deception. Even if you can say to yourself, that's true and that's the way I feel, be wise and say, that's true and that's the way I feel, but I'm going to pray that the Lord lead me away from temptation. Because that way you're really joining him against the flesh that's in you. You're joining your spirit to his spirit against the flesh that you've yielded to. And you're saying, yes, I've yielded to it, but I'm going to bring the Lord in, and we're going to get the extra big guns out, and we're going to get rid of my desire to be tempted. That's a wise prayer. A wise prayer is that, Lord, give me the spirit of repentance. That's a wise prayer. Yeah, that could be tough on you. It's going to be tough on your flesh, believe me. Just pray, Lord, give me a spirit of repentance. That's a tough prayer. Meditate about that and think about it. But the results are fruitfulness. It's going to be tough. But God, the Lord loves to hear those kinds of prayers from a heart that says, I am a sinner, Lord. God, help me. He loves that. Oh, God, I don't need the devil to tempt me. I'm already tempted without him. Help me. God appreciates that kind of transparency and honesty and wisdom. Help me, Holy God. That's what Paul prayed, 7th chapter, Romans. So, there is the prayer, the Lord's Prayer, Sammy's right in there, great need for us to exercise it. And we have a little time today, so I'm primarily going to share on the first part of chapter 5. And what I'd like for you to do is, if you would look at the first few verses of chapter 5, and then as it starts, and you see there in verse 3, it says, "Blessed are the poor in spirit." And I want you to see here as we move through just these few verses, and then we'll be done, the spiritual growth progression as seen in the order of the blessings. And it's interesting how you'll see it if it's brought to your attention. The first thing is, blessed are the poor in spirit. Well, what does that mean to be poor in spirit? Well, it's to see our need. It's to see our need in our spirit, a need for regeneration. Poor in spirit is an acknowledgement of where we are before we know the Lord. You're not poor in spirit if you've been born again. You see what I'm saying? The first qualification for the inheritance in the kingdom of heavens is to be born again. If you haven't been born again, you have no hope, no chance, no promise before you to be a part of the kingdom of heavens. Blessed are the poor in spirit, those that acknowledge their need. That initial need of a move on their own spirit to unite their spirit with the Lord. Blessed are the poor in spirit. Does it say, blessed are you who are poor in spirit? Or does it say, blessed are the poor in spirit? Blessed are you if you are poor in spirit. Blessed are you if you continue in poorness of spirit. Is that what it says? You know, it's a reference to the world. Blessed are those who are poor in the spirit, who recognize, who have come to the conclusion that they are poor in spirit. But once they're regenerated, then now they have the opportunity for the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. That's what's set before us. Every one of us, what's set before us is the kingdom of heavens. And then the next step, the next progression, after the renewed spirit, that's based on the mercy and the grace of Jesus Christ's atonement, the next blessing has to do with the progression. Blessed are they that mourn. Mourn. Then, not only do they bless because they mourn, but they continue in mourning. It's a present tense, isn't it? Blessed are they that mourn. Not blessed are they that mourned, or blessed are you that mourn. That mourned. It's a present tense. So I'm saying, it's good for us to mourn. It's a dynamic that's little understood, because people being in Christendom would suggest that mourning was something that shows lack of faith, lack of joy, lack of peace even. But in reality, mourning is a dynamic that has to do with our state of progression. You know, how great was the mourning of those who found themselves confronted with the Word of God more and more. It isn't just a one-time confronting. I was poor in the spirit, and I mourned, and now I'm no longer mourning. Now I am full of joy and peace and happiness, and mourning has been done away with. It is a continual, progressive mourning as you get more and more light, more and more revelation of Jesus Christ. The greater the exceeding sinfulness of sin is. The more spiritual you are, the greater the propensity to mourn. So throughout our lives, in the growing understanding of that exceedingly sinfulness of sin, the depraved condition, that of the flesh nature within, that's an ability to see the dynamic of the wrestling in the womb, right? The wrestling of the womb of the twins. It's that dynamic that you're able to recognize that there's two in me, and there's this war going on. What is this? Why is this? She cried. Why is this going, this wrestling going on inside my womb? Well, there's two in you. There's two. There's two natures now in you. Blessed were you when you were poor in the spirit. And now that with the rebirth of the spirit, there now are two in you. There are the flesh and the spirit. The enlivened spirit. And the spirit continually mourns. As the more light is flooded into the spirit, that floods more light into the onto the carnality, that other part of you that's in you, then there is an additional growing and mourning. An increasing of awareness of our flesh's propensity towards pride and self-love. And great sense of the need of the power of the Spirit daily in our heart. Without this mourning, without this revelation that brings about the mourning, there would be no spiritual hunger and thirst. It's a revelation of seeing your inferiority. What I always said was, it's where God meets you. It's where you meet God. This is where the vacuum is created. You see your insufficiency in the light of His all-sufficiency. That's where faith is birthed. That's where mourning is birthed. If you ever see yourself in light, in the light of God's excellence, and how you so fall short, and you see His greatness, His willingness to elevate you into a different way, that it creates a humbleness, that creates a mourning. It's a mourning of, oh my God, woe is me, I have seen God. Woe, I'm not worthy. Depart from me, Lord. I am a man. This is a good thing. If you can mourn because you have met God, because faith has been created, because you've seen your insufficiency, and in that creates this void where He comes rushing in. Faith says, please help, help. The mourning is a cry to God for help. And that doesn't stop after you just one time when you were poor in spirit and you were born again. But it's an ongoing, blessed are those that mourn. Why? For they shall be comforted. Not a one-time comforting, but a continual, daily comforting. Yes, I see it. I see what you've done. I see that. I see your repentance. I see that you see now what that will do and where that will lead. And you are, I see your heart. I see you quivering at my word. Be comforted. I love you. I will strengthen you. I will help you. I will deliver you. I will keep you from all your enemies. I will protect you. That's the power of the Spirit of God. And the little S and big S, that's that power of the Spirit being brought to bear upon our heart. It's the discovery of the Comforter in the process of working out our salvation. Fear and trembling has a connotation of mourning, doesn't it? I mean, if you were fear and trembling, would you be mourning? Whoa, yeah. Well, your whole life is just a steady progression of fear and trembling. If it's not, you're walking on some self-presumption or apathy. You aren't walking in harmony and reality and fellowship. You may have some days where you feel exhilarated because you've had some victory, but they won't last long because there's too much work to be done and not enough time to get it done in. The Lord is going to work on you, sharpen you, press you, smash you. He's going to work you all your life. And let you say, whoa, stop, I don't want anymore. But boy, if you'll stay with him, you won't have very many days of victorious shouting hallelujahs. You'll be mourning. There's victory in mourning. There's fruit in mourning. It's not like you're downcast. It's not. I walk in a state of mourning about 90% of the time. And that's a good place because I believe that, when I'm my weakest, he is his strongest. He can do his best work when I don't have a lick of strength. And when I'm in me and I do it, it is an Ishmael every time. But if I got him, and I know that, I like to stay in a state of mourning. People go, why don't you just lift yourself up out of the mully grubs or, oh, you woe is me and stuff. No, it's not what you think. Yeah, I know what you're thinking, but it ain't what you're thinking. Man, I find joy in mourning. I find joy and peace and love when I'm confronted with the Almighty God. I don't feel condemned or convicted that I'm a no good nothing. I feel lifted and hopeful because it's him I'm looking at. I got my eye on him. I love that. I get my eye on me. Everything's good and fine, and I can get it done myself. That's not a good place. I'm trying to show you that there's progression. Once we're born again, there's this state of that we should stay in. It's a reverential fear of God is what it is. This Romans 8:26 is the scripture that I referenced to. Many of you know it. It's about the Spirit. The Spirit helps us in our weaknesses, in our infirmities, in prayers that cannot be uttered in articulate speech. Woe and mourning. Mourning. Whoa, mourning. That is the Holy Spirit will help us pray, intercede, and comfort us. That's that Romans 8:26 work. At work. Blessed then are those who are in and remain in the state of meek. The next verse, he opens up this other progression. Blessed are the meek. Do you think the Lord ordered these things, or he just kind of randomly threw out a bunch of stuff and hoped something stick? These are ordered by the divine God. They're in that order that he meant them to be. When you're poor in spirit, that's the first progression. And then the second thing, mourning. And the third thing, meek. He's speaking to blessed are they that are meek. Blessed are the meek. And those that stay and remain in the state of meek. Meek is the summary of different workings of spirituality being wrought or brought to bear upon the heart by hearing of the words of Jesus and making him Lord of our lives. Meekness is hearing. Hearing and seeing. It creates humbleness and lowliness. And we're teachable. When we're meek, we're teachable. Well, when we know it all, God has a hard time getting through to us. And I'm talking about through people. People can't talk to us because we're unteachable. We know everything. We got everything. You're stupid and I'm smart. That's unteachable. And God can't reach it. And it's not meek. There's no meekness in it. That's what the Lord likes about that meek state. It'll be. Patty read me a list of things yesterday. It was really good. It's sent. Some of you all might have got it too. It was sent by Jebba. Jebba to whoever. I know Patty got it, and she was reading it as I was driving, just highlighting things, just different attributes of what practical way of living, looking at things. Don't sweat the small stuff. All stuff is small. Different statements, and in that, I heard meekness. I heard this is a person who is exercising these things is meek. It's a condition free from the wrath of God. That's a wonderful thing. If you're meek, you can be assured you are not about to experience the wrath of God. That's another reason to stay right there in mourning. Stay meek. Always reminding you yourself of who you are. Isn't that a good thing? Huh? Come on now. So you're you, in this state of meekness, you're staying in the spirit of life. Romans 8, 1 through 5. You're staying in the spirit of life. The law of the spirit of life in Christ Jesus has set you free from the law of sin and death. Moses' law brings sin and death. But the law of the spirit of life in Christ Jesus brings a freedom and an imputed righteousness. And the imputed righteousness is the state of meekness. It would be hard to stay. It's like having no oxygen, running out of oxygen. When you have no meekness, you're going to be losing the ability to be righteous. It's like having an air tank on and being underwater and running out of air. When you run out of meekness, it's going to be hard for you to maintain under the water. Death. Baptism, where you're supposed to go die under there, you know? Meekness is a life-giving force in the sense of the spirit of life. Meekness brings life. Meekness allows us to walk in imputed righteousness. We need imputed righteousness to continue in the walk. The walk for what? Can anybody tell me what I've been talking about here? Huh? Kingdom. Keep in mind, I'm speaking to you about, teaching you, not preaching, about the qualifications of those that would inherit the kingdom of heavens. Meekness. Without meekness, you're not going to inherit the kingdom of heavens. That's what I'm saying. You run out of meekness, you're going to surface, you're going to allow the flesh to resurrect, you're going to exclude yourself from the promise of inheritance. You're going to have meekness. Let's incorporate it. It's not all that difficult. I mean, it is initially. But as you grow and you learn, this is the state to be in. Not the state that I've been living in all these years. This is a much better state. Even though I thought it was going to be really tough, it's a much better place to be. When you get there, you've incorporated it. You don't have to worry about running out of it, because you won't. Because it's just too important. It's extremely important to you. And so you've overcome. You're exercising meekness. You can exercise meekness on a one-time, two-time, off-time basis. I'm talking about incorporating it. But if you do incorporate it, if you do exercise meekness, humbleness, teachability, it become your nature, because that's what Christ is there inside of you to do. That's what we have prayed, isn't it? That's why we're incorporating, we're pulling it, we're standing in imputed righteousness, we're asking the Holy Spirit to help us, we're praying, we're doing, we're qualifying. That becomes pretty valuable to us. Somebody needs to tell us that we need it. Somebody needs to tell you need meekness if you're going to get into the kingdom of heavens. How about that? Does that work? Does that work for you? Does it work to you? How about if I screamed it at the top of my lungs, which right now would be very difficult because I have a catch in my throat. Huh? If I screamed it at you, or maybe if I just flamed on, you know, if I just turned into flames, I just burnt up right before your eyes and become ashes. And as I was screaming, you got to have meekness. Would that indelibly put it upon your heart and mind that you got to maintain in meekness if you're going to inherit the kingdom of heavens? Would it? Would me if one of you burned up right now? Really from there on, I'd know what meekness meant. Pretty important. I remember when Jane burned up right there in the chair, she became a pile of ashes. We got to hammer ourselves in our mind with the importance of being meek. It is something the Lord said, blessed are the meek, for they will inherit, right? If you're not meek, you're not going to inherit. The meek condition is one of patience and wisdom in suffering persecutions. James 1:21. Wherefore? Who return not evil for evil, does not threaten, but prays and blesses those who persecute. Evil for evil. I'm good at it. I got a doctorate in evil for evil. Yeah, I can give you, give me a spoonful, I'll give you a bucket load. I've got a doctorate. Evil for evil, people. Goodness for evil is what the Lord is goodness. He didn't turn. When he was reviled, he reviled not. Yes, Patty, you want to repent?
One of the things that little saying said yesterday was be kind. And then it said be kind to the unkind. Mm. And what you're saying is that it's easy to be kind for those that are kind to you. But whenever you run into somebody that is not kind or does something evil to you, well then we figure we're justified then to treat them equally.
Yeah, they deserve it.
And what you'll never find the Lord ever saying is someone does you wrong, you are justified now to be ugly to them or to treat them aloof or cut them off or whatever. We're told to forgive. And this is how you show the character of Christ. It's easy to forgive whenever, or else we make some little sins or big sins. I'll forgive you on that little sin, but this is a big one, and I'm going to forgive you. And then it takes it another step. It said forgive. That was another thing that was said in that, is to forgive. And especially if you're asked, will you please forgive me, and you refuse to forgive someone? I mean, these are really things we have to be confronted with if we're mature Christians. If you're immature, then I expect you to act like that. But if you're mature and you know the Lord for a while, you need to forgive when somebody asks you to forgive them. Whether it was a little sin or what you consider a huge sin. We, as believers, as Christians, if we love the Lord, who has forgiven us such horrible sins, and we want to hold something against someone, and they've asked for forgiveness, how can we say that we're believers and we love God and we won't forgive them?
Will you forgive me?
Thank you.
Go beyond that, though,
you have to forgive them when they don't ask.
Yeah. Yes. Yeah. Well, now that's another step of maturity, is even forgiving when you haven't been asked to forgive.
Well, you guys are getting out of my linear box. I was running this real nice progression, and you guys are all over my board here. If you won't be humble, I'll humble you.
Walk in the Spirit.
Also kind of go back to Old Testament versus the New Testament, because in the Old Testament it doesn't talk about an eye for an eye and tooth for a tooth. Whereas, you know, the law of Christ is not like that. And so it does show the progression that you are supposed to make into the law of Christ.
Return good for evil, not evil for evil. That's what James is saying. That's what Jesus is saying here when he's speaking about being meek. It's misunderstood in the world as weakness. Did you have another thing to say?
Well, I think most people, I'm just speaking from my own experience, we're afraid to forgive when somebody asks us to forgive them because we think they'll do it to us again, or they'll do something maybe even worse, or whatever. So we'll withhold our forgiveness from them for a time to teach them a lesson.
As one of the clever designs of the devil, what you haven't understood correctly is that immediate asking of forgiveness in sincerity creates a fruit on your tree that they can't help but eat of. I will. What we haven't been able to clearly see, because the devil has given us this is what the truth is, that if you forgive often, they'll take advantage of you and maybe even do more than they'd even create and do more worse things to you than because they see that they can abuse you. In reality, when it comes to the Lord's people, Christians, husbands, wives, fathers, sons, daughters, the reality is the quicker you ask them to forgive, the sooner you grow a fruit on your tree that when they eat of that tree, they now become like what they see. See, what they're involved in. They're eating of your fruit now. You're not eating of their fruit. Their fruit is hold it, get it, maintain it, root of bitterness, whatever it is. But you're not. Yours is forgive me. Forgive me. Forgive me. And you're thinking, the more I say this, the worse it's going to get. But in reality, the more that you willfully and really practically put into practice the forgiveness, which means I don't hold it against you, I don't bring it up ever again, I forget about it, I love you instead, I treat you the same and better than I did before, those is reality of fruit. That fruit they'll see, they'll eat, and they'll become like that. The quicker it'll happen, the longer that you maintain this posture of I can't forgive because if I do, or at least I'll forgive, but I ain't going to tell them I forgive them because they're going to do something again and do it again because they think that's a license. That kind of thinking is what's stopping them from growth and stops you from growth. You don't see that God wants you to do what he wants you to do whether they do anything or not. And you grow. And in the grace comes to withstand. If they sinned against you 7 times 70 in one day, you'd have the grace. If you exercise the forgive them, as the Lord said. How many times should I forgive them? 7 times? No, 70 times 7. You see, it is God hath, God really said. That's the first thing he comes with. Somebody does you wrong, and you think, well, the Lord says forgive. Yeah, but he didn't mean that. He meant, you know, if you tell them you forgive them, you're in trouble because you know what's going to happen. They're going to, see, that's a hath God really said. They got an argument to offset what you are supposed to do. You're supposed to be meek. Meek turns the other cheek. Meek says, I'm sorry. Meek. Yes, Patty?
You get to choose whether you're going to forgive or not. You're going to choose whether you're going to let that fruit grow on your tree, and you get to choose to be meek. This is the power that the enemy has stolen away from us, is our choices of choosing to forgive, whether they deserve it or not, or even, as you said, whether they ask or not. We choose to do that today.
Most marriages are because people didn't choose to be meek. Most marriages are lost or in a state of cold war because we've chosen to take our side against the other in this war. And what happens is it creates a dynamic that is ungodly. And I was faced with it, and I know that all of you have been faced with it that have been married or are married. It's a battle. It's not an easy thing to do to die to yourself. But as I've said many times, if God can't find an adversary for you, he'll find a mate. You know, we always pray, God, send me the right person. Well, there she is. Live with it. That's the right one for you because you had a lot of needs. And she's going to point every one of them out for you. You think, I'm not kidding here. I'm not kidding. If you want the right mate so you might be godly, you might be surprised on what he gives you. That's the reality. That's not, I know it's kind of funny, but.
Right? Mark really needs to be sitting here for this. But he's being meek and cleaning up my water.
These are realities, people, and it's the dynamic that Christ is calling us to, and he's put us in these circumstances. There, you know, what the devil meant for harm will be to our glory. Yeah, it'll be to our glory if we will do what he's asking us to do here to qualify for the kingdom of heavens, which is to rule and reign with him and have glory in us. If we'll put these things in exercise, if we will be meek, It has a great recompense and reward. You can not choose not to. You can choose just to stay in your merely born again state and not exercise these things. You won't be qualified for the kingdom of heaven. And you may be in your own little kingdom, your own little world, but it is going to pale in comparison to what you could have if you'd have just heeded. If you'd have just heeded, it's like the Psalm of Solomon. The Song of Solomon, you know, in Ecclesiastes. It's that state that Solomon came to after living a whole life ignoring the Lord, the Spirit of the Lord. And then coming to his last days, he then started seeing what it is that he had given up. Now he says, my circulatory system is giving up on me. My teeth are starting to fall out of my head. My hair is turning white. And I have not learned one thing. Why didn't I listen to God? Why didn't I repent? Why wasn't I correctable and instructable? That's where we're going. That's where we'll be. If we don't incorporate these things in us now, when we get there, we had our own little kingdom. He had his own kingdom. He was the greatest in the world, man. They sought him out. He's got more wisdom than anybody. Big deal. Look what he gave up. He gave up the kingdom of God. It was rent from him. Jeff?
There's another perspective on grace. I had a coworker, and this guy would always inflict as much as he could on me, and I would always forgive him and just kept with a smile. And eventually he admitted to me that he was doing it on purpose. But the reason why, because he wanted to make sure I was really the truth. I was really the true Christian. And he was tested. I never knew that. That's a whole other perspective. I never even thought.
Well, yeah, that's a good story. It's a good story. He might have been an angel. I'm not sure. That would. Kathy?
I was determined with the help of the Spirit of God to start operating in that as far as the benefit of the Father for things in life. And it's been kind of a funny thing between Jerry and I, especially when he does all the driving. And I've been teaching these things so that he will be nice to the people on the road.
Instead of calling them idiots.
I don't know anything about that. What?
If we practice this in our daily life, not just at home, but in our community, think what a force we would be in changing the world. And to me, that's what the Christian community has lost, is that what you're talking about, walking in that meekness, walking in forgiveness, instead of saying negative and harmful things about people you don't even know because they just teach you off, they'll say, cut in front of you, pray for that person. I said, Jerry, if anything, just pray that they learn how to drive.
Yesterday, that list that we, Patty and I, were referring to on it, it says, go the whole day without criticizing somebody. So we were getting ready to start our 6-hour journey home, and Patty says, I think she said it. I'm going to give her credit for it. She said, maybe you could exercise that and not criticize anybody on driving today. I said, okay, I'm going to do that. I'm not going to criticize anybody on the way they drive today. And I'm telling you, I had about 20 opportunities that I could have. I kept grabbing my mouth, Yeah, and that's the reality. If we look at it from the Lord's perspective, his view, how foolish we are, immature we are, and how we think we are as opposed to the way we are. I think I'm okay. But then you ought to listen to, if the Lord played back a tape recorder of you all day long, then you could listen to you all day. That guy doesn't know nothing about Christ. Listen to him. This is what he is wanting, this dialogue, this energy, this commitment, this consecration, this salt and light coming alive in you and I to bring about the reality of what it is he's trying to do. This is not positive thinking. This is not positive something. This is true nature change. This is character that Christ is going to want to work out in the willing. He's not going to say, Kathy, be whatever. Kathy B., whatever. It's going to be Kathy wanting to have what it is that the Lord is giving her, offering to her, and her seeking it and panting after it and wanting it and committing her life to doing it. That's what's going to qualify her for the kingdom of heavens. Don't matter, not important to you today. You're more about today, you know, more about, you know, how to get food on the table or whatever. Well, that's why these three chapters, I said one of the overlying themes of one of the things in here is seek ye first the kingdom of God and His righteousness. That's the reality. You may be compelled almost. I mean, you're just shaken with your circumstances, but you need to get a hold of your mind and say, hey, take no thought. What will I eat? What will I drink? What will I wear? Saying that sort of stuff. What are we going to do? And you're just driving your mate crazy too. You know. Seek ye first, you dummy. Seek ye first the kingdom. What does that mean? Drop to your knees first. Drop right there and pray. Well, I'm a mess and I can't help but think about all my messes. Would you please help me? That's the reality. We got to get a hold of that instead of trying to make New Year resolutions that don't hold up very long and then go back into our old ways. We got to incorporate this stuff on a daily basis. And to do that, we have to have a commitment and we have to have the Word of God implanting it. Patty, have you got another thing to say? This is your day. Go for it, girl. Did you have some caffeine or coffee or you had some chicken? Some chicken filet.
One of the things to being a mother is that we've got all age groups in here, but you have to understand that what you're doing for yourself is between you and the Lord and for yourself first, but you are having an effect on not only fruit for the other people out there, but for the fruit that's in your lineage. And as you do what you're doing today, it's going to have a deep impact on your children. Because they are always going to be eating off the fruit of your tree, no matter if they're 4 years old or they're 45. Mm-hmm. They're still going to be eating off of our tree and the fruit that we're bearing. Mm-hmm. And let that, nobody gets away with that. Mm-hmm. As you sow, you're going to reap. Mm-hmm. And those kids are always, whether they're with you or they're grown and moved away, spiritually, they're still eating off the fruit of our tree. And so it's very important. In that aspect, too, and what parent doesn't want their kid to be better and do better than we did? We all do. It starts with us. If we don't, we have to do this. It's a joy, and it's available, and we can do it.
Okay. Amen.
I'm done. When I think of the word meek, I always think of just to set more of you, less of me. Mm-hmm. I mean, and a lot of times when I'm feeling pretty proud, and most of the time mine, like this week, has been where I feel like somebody's wronging Mark or wronging my children. And that's where I'm like, nah, you're not going to do that. I'm not going to allow it. Not going to happen. And I have to remind myself, more of you, less of me. Even mm-hmm. though I'm defending something that I believe 100% in,
sure.
I've got to back off. And
yeah.
Go, not me.
Yeah.
It's not me.
Not me because I'm not going to trust in me. Mm-hmm. I can trust in me and might have some success. I might defend my husband and I might have some form of success. But it will be less than what success than what I would have had if I'd have trusted in the Lord. The success comes in me and in life. He shows himself real. If we do that, if we exercise a trust in him, yeah. We are often tested on in good things. It's not just all bad things. I mean, I want to provide for my children, but that's not always the best thing. I want to give, but that's not always the best thing. I want a loan, but that's not always the best thing. Trust in the Lord and his spirit and his wisdom and prayerfully seek him. And having a meek spirit could be just being quiet. I got a word. Well, that's your word. We don't need that. You know what I'm saying? You just sometimes just being quiet is the best solution to an issue. Sometimes just being quiet, which is trusting the Lord. That's meek. And I'll tell you one dang thing. You ain't going to get it right. That's so easy. That's so easy. The flesh, you let that flesh go. But it doesn't bear the fruit for the Lord. All right, I'm going to continue here. Y'all are going to be guilty for keeping us late, not me. No, I'll hurry. The meek condition is one of patience and wisdom in suffering persecutions. Jesus set us an example in the cross, and ours is also in like manner to pick up the cross and willingly suffer as a consequence of righteousness. Righteousness, you know, to suffer for something that is not righteous is not has any merit, doesn't have any merit. But to suffer for righteousness' sake is what Christ has called us to daily. I've said, Curtis likes it, I say it, is pick up the popcorn, you know, the little things, doing. That sets the tone for doing something great. If you aren't doing the little things, you're not going to do any great things. Thus, it is given in the behalf of Christ not only to believe in Him, but also to suffer for His sake. Philippians 1:29. I believe that was the scripture that was read today in worship. Meekness must be incorporated in our lives before we can make real spiritual progress in the inheritance of the kingdom. So what we've seen is a poor in spirit, mourning, and meekness. Mourning and being meek are continuing traits of some who are wise. Matthew 25:1 speaks of the wise and the foolish virgins. Matthew 25:1-3. All those virgins had received the oil, right? The Holy Spirit. They'd all had been born again. They all have had imputed righteousness, but what they all didn't do was continue. Five continued, but five were foolish. Five continued in what? What's the next progression here in our spiritual furtherance? As blessed as they which do hunger and thirst after righteousness. Righteousness is an acquired taste. That's something that just came to my mind when I was typing. You know, you acquire taste for beer. I never liked it until I started drinking a lot of it, and then I liked it. It's an acquired taste. I don't think beer tastes good. I think you have to drink more of it to get the acquired taste for it. Or anything else. I'm just using beer and me as an example. And I'm talking about when I was young here, by the way. It's not a vice anymore. I don't drink it, but my example is that it's an acquired taste. Righteousness is an acquired taste. You got to continue in doing righteous deeds in actions and thoughts. You have to exercise them, and then you'll begin to acquire more and more of a hunger and a thirst. This hunger and thirst after righteousness is a spiritual state of growing or ewing out in capacity. What is hunger and thirsting after righteousness? It's a working, a chiseling on your own rock hard heart. That's what it is. You just take a hammer and a chisel and you work on your own heart. That's what you're doing when you're hungering and thirsting after righteousness. No need to encourage you to hunger and thirst after something you have, right? Why would the Lord be saying, blessed are those that hunger and thirst after righteousness? Why would he say that to his disciples? if they had already received, you know, whatever they had needed in that initial rebirth, there is a capacitating here. There is a growing in righteousness that he is calling them to. It's the same thing as Colossians 3:2, where it says, setting your affections on things above. Wherever you set your affections, that becomes your desire. That's what causes hunger and thirst. Hunger and thirst for beer, or hunger and thirst for righteousness. Hunger and thirst for things of the world, or a hunger and thirst for righteousness. You're the one that sets the affection. You're the one that stays the mind. You're the one that makes the choice. It isn't something that just comes on you randomly. The Lord says that he won't allow you to be tested and tempted above that you're able and capable. That's for his children. That's a promise to his children. You're never going to stand before the Lord and say, well, I was just tempted and tested beyond my capabilities. Because that's a lie. The truth is, you set your affection. You didn't set your affection. You would not hear or heed or listen. Setting your affections on things above causes hunger and thirst for righteousness, which God continues to feed with his word. He feeds your hunger and thirst for righteousness. And he does it by the means of his word. Lukewarm is descriptive of having no hunger or thirst for righteousness. You have no hunger or thirst for righteousness? That's a pretty good telltale sign of your lukewarmness. You're temperate. You have no hunger or thirst for righteousness. You don't care. You're just going through the motions. That's a pretty good sign of lukewarmness. It's a state of satisfaction with worldly things. It's the sad and sorry state of a Christian discovered at the judgment seat of Christ, who had received Jesus Christ's gift of righteousness and refuses to be hungry and thirsty for the great prize of promised blessing. And then the next beatitude or blessing is being merciful. Be merciful, for you'll attain mercy. I think most of us got a pretty good picture of what that is, because we all need mercy. But I don't know that we exercise mercy, but we sure solicit it. Being merciful is the first action directive here of Jesus to the disciples. Notice that he says here, blessed are they. But here now he says, blessed are the merciful, or blessed are you who are merciful. Jesus is directing his disciples in being merciful. It is the early spring fruit of the beneficiary who has abided in the vine of the benefactor. You know, we're willing to be beneficiaries, but I don't know. We're not too good at wanting to be benefactors. And it is to the benefactor state that the Lord is calling us. You know, Matthew 13, Mark 4. Sower sows the word. God sows the word in you so he might sow you into the world. You haven't got any, if you're not producing in 30, 60, or 100 fold, if you're not producing anything, you aren't sowable. I don't think that's a word, but you can't be sown if you have nothing sown in you. You're of no use in the kingdom of God, promoting the kingdom of God, the kingdom of heaven, because you have not had anything sowed into you. You hadn't allowed that's been sowed in you to take root and produce fruit. You're just hard old rocky soil, or you've refused to grow. The ground's not good. And so you live a whole life being a beneficiary. Air and breathe. Oh, this feels good. Oh, that's sight. Isn't that beautiful? You're just always a beneficiary. You're never a merciful benefactor. One of the things that Patty read yesterday was give some unworn clothes to Goodwill or something like that. You know, give something that's not a throwaway. Yeah, that, there you'd be a benefactor, wouldn't you? But the other is kind of, you've been a beneficiary and just handing the stuff that you no longer want away. There's a difference. And how do you become a benefactor? You have to abide. Isn't that what it says in John 15? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5? It says, if you don't abide in the vine, you won't produce fruit. If you don't produce fruit, you are like a withered old branch or worth nothing. God cut it off. He's the husband, and he piles it up and he burns it. Okay, well, there's the loss of the soul. There's the loss of the kingdom of heavens. You've excluded yourself because you weren't fruitful. You weren't merciful. You weren't a benefactor. You weren't meek. You didn't abide. So, having no sympathy for others. Mercifulness is having sympathy for others. Do you know how you become merciful? Just be beat up a lot. Yeah, because then you think, I know what it feels like to be beat up. I am just not going to beat this person up. Now, the world is, you toughen up. I'm going to beat you up to toughen you up. That's the way the world looks. Get tough there. And then they create this ungodliness in you because you've been tutored by the world. But the Lord's way is that you learn by other people exercising that merciless attitudes on you and how it feels, and you take it to heart. And you exercise it. Now you have the grace. Man, they can't do nothing to you that creates a hard heart. Because your heart's focused toward the Lord. He was merciful, and look what he suffered for me. And they piled it on him. I mean, they piled it, kept beating him and sent him back and forth, beat him some more. How about some more? How'd you like to get some more? You stinking Jew. How about some thorns? How about this? How about that? Now carry your own cross. We're going to nail you to it. On and on. All the things. You know, that's just the physical side. How about the spiritual side? Anyway, what I'm saying is, there's our example of merciful. He's merciful to us. He's allowed us. He's invited us. And this person here just cut us off. Send them to hell. They deserve it. They do. I mean, who do they think they are? That's what I mean. Play back our voice all day long to us a couple of days in a row, and we'll see what our big needs are. Patty having to listen to me gripe about every driver on the road is like the Lord playing it back to me, you know. It's hard to be humble when you're perfect. That is laughable there. I just laugh at myself on that one. I'm probably the world's worst driver, and I have the critique of critiquers. But I'm probably the world's worst. I probably abused driving more than any human being. I'm telling you, I was purposely an imperfect. I mean, if it wouldn't have been the angels of God, I wouldn't even be here because of my driving. No kidding. And somebody said, man, your angels' wings are tattered. They sure are. I mean, I have beat the sides of them off of those cars, and I feel like I can tell everybody how to drive. God forgive me. It's just a little thing, but it transcends just that. It goes into everything. I become the best critiquer of everything, you know. Cooking. Man, what's this? It tastes like, I know all about food and how it should be prepared. I'm just saying, this is not the attitudes or character that will inherit the kingdom of heavens. It won't do it. It'll be in the kingdom of heavens. I mean, I'll have a place somewhere. but it won't be in close proximity to him. I'll be far. They'll be passing out, you know, binoculars for me, so I can see the Lord. There he is. I see him. I got to change this, and I'm getting old too. I'm about to kick out of here, and I haven't got much time left to try to get this done. I'm telling you, I need a real dose of exponential something to get me over the hill here. I mean, those lessons are lessons you should have learned a while ago. Why are you still today worrying about this stupid stuff? Why are you acting this way? Well, I'm quick to repent, I must say. I am. That's an improvement. I may be continuing, but I'm quicker to repent. I see. I did that yesterday. I'm faster today. Please forgive me, Lord. I didn't let 10 seconds go by before I was already saying, yep. Who? Someone? Raise their hand. Cat?
That's the same thing. You were saying that you just torn off your wings, but if that's the same thing, getting in by the smell of smoke.
Yeah. Yeah, really. It really is. It's your butt has just been hit, you know, the backstop has fallen over into the pit. You know, you just escape. But escape from what? You know, that's what I've spent a long time, a few years educating us scripturally on what we are escaping from. And, you know, we talk about the smell of smoke, and it's got some scriptural basis to it. That's just as that scripture I quoted there in John 15, Kat. John 15, where the Lord said that the husband will gather those sticks up and burn them. Well, he's speaking to those that had been in the vine that didn't produce fruit. And many examples. So even though we will be a part of the kingdom in the long run, we'll be excluded from the millennial kingdom. And during that millennial kingdom, there's that purging that I've talked about many times. There is the reward, the recompense of good and evil that the servants of God will be accountable for at the judgment seat of Christ. And I'm thinking that not only will you smell like smoke, you will have been in the fire. Because if we don't allow ourselves to be purged here, we're going to be purged. One way or another, you're going to be purged. Because he's the author and the finisher. He's going to finish it. We can participate with him and help him and get a reward for it, or we can just allow him to do it for us, but he's going to do it. He's going to purge you. And I not only think you're going to smell like smoke, but you're going to experience some fire. Because it is a fearful thing, Hebrews 10 says, to fall into the hands of the consuming fire. And that's not just said to the, you know, those are believers again. In Hebrews 6, it's the believers again. What we're talking about here in these three chapters, it's the believers. So we haven't rightly divided the Word of God, and we don't see the downside, really. We haven't seen the upside, and we haven't seen the downside. He keeps us kind of blinded, he being our enemy. He that in reality, we're engaged in a war with. We're blinded by his lies. Okay, I know that's a long-winded cat, but that's what I'm saying. So, having more fully comprehended his mercy towards his creation, and having like mercy is the evidence of granted wisdom and understanding in the knowledge of God. Ephesians chapter 1, 17 and 18. Exercising mercy is a sign that you have understood more clearly and had the knowledge of God, the mercy of God and the knowledge of God. And then finally here we have, blessed are the pure in heart, for they will see God. Pure in heart speaks to the spiritual condition of the believer in Christ. I tried to come up with this thought. I had a thought that the Lord is the filter, like a water filter. And I couldn't get there. I couldn't make it work. I got it started in my mind. I was exercising this thought. you know, what we're speaking, the Lord says, those that want to qualify for the kingdom of heavens have got to be pure in heart. So that I see as regeneration is the first time through that filter. But then the Lord, there's some state you're pure. At what point you're pure is the point that you've exercised, you know, after this poor in spirit, after you've exercised the mourning and the meekness and the forgiveness, after you've been exercising these things, you're running yourself through this filter, and at some point you're pure. You're pure at heart. And that's what we're doing. We're working with the Lord for a purity of heart. In our just merely born again state, we are not of pure heart. This pure heart speaks to that spiritual condition of the believer in Christ. So what is implied by Jesus is that no believer merely born again is pure in heart. The old nature contaminates the heart. Progressively, you know, that's what we do. We muddy the waters. We take mud and we plop it in the middle of there and it just kind of... So the old nature contaminates the heart, and progressively we are to attain pure hearts. The words of Jesus are the filter through which we run our natural nature, and that by our wills. The heart condition of every believer will be judged by Jesus Christ. Purity speaks to the reception and the application of truth brought to bear upon the old nature by three means. Three I can see. First one, this I bring out in Hebrews 10, 19 through 23. These are the verses that I use to bring about this purity that Jesus is talking about. It comes to our old nature, goes through these states and these stages and this purifying by, number one, entering into the holiest. Enter into the holiest. Initially, through the renewed spirit, by belief in Jesus Christ's saving atonement. Saving atonement blood. That's how we enter into the holiest. We can't enter into the holiest unless we are born again. Unless we have had a poor spirit and recognized how poor we were in spirit, we are not going to be able to enter into the holiest. So the first stage, first state in this purifying of our hearts is to enter into the holiest. Second is by daily communion with Jesus. The encouraging word there in Hebrews is, let us draw near. How do you draw near to the throne of grace and mercy? How do you draw near? Through the blood of Jesus Christ. How do you draw near? Through the word and prayer and the power of the Spirit. Little S and big S. That's how you draw near. In full assurance of faith. In full assurance of faith. Right here, again. That conflict, that introspection, that seeing God as God and seeing you as you, that's that full assurance, seeing Him in full assurance of faith, that I have access here and that I have a right to be here. I've been invited here. I'm here because He wants to fellowship with me and commune with me and impart to me grace and mercy that I might attain unto the prize, that I might qualify for the inheritance of the kingdom of heavens. That's the second thing. I have to be born again, and then I have to commune. I have to draw near. And then I have to have my heart sprinkled. Our hearts have to be sprinkled by the cleansing or the purifying effect that is brought to bear up to our conscience. Our conscience says don't. Our conscience says do. And we hear, we implement. This is sprinkling and purifying our hearts. When I listen to my conscience and I allow my conscience to lead me into truth, incorporate truth into me, then I'm sprinkling my heart with the purifying water and the blood and the word and the power of the Holy Spirit that is cleansing my water. It's running it through that filter. That's That's the second means. This is a part of that second means, approaching, drawing near. And I can't just draw near in my sin. You know, I can draw near my first time because I'm now poor in spirit and I've recognized it and I'm repentant. And I say, oh God, well, I'm a sinner. Please save me. And he does. Now I have access. Okay, draw near, he says. And I can't draw near with crap all over me. I got to clean up a little bit. If I don't clean up, I can't get close. Are you with me? I got to clean up. What do you have to do to clean up? I got to be sprinkled again. I got to sprinkle. I got to wash my hands and my feet. I'm clean whole, but my hands and my feet have touched the world. I've got to be purified again. I have to continue in purifying to draw near in fellowship with him. So that's the part of that second thing. That's willingly putting on the clothes of righteousness and denying the flesh. That's that putting on and putting off. I've got to be doing that. And to do that, to draw near to God, I've got to be in a state of purifying myself, cleansing myself by repentance and doing and acting and walking in the Spirit. And then the third thing is, and final thing, is I've got to be persistent. I've got to be continuing. Persistent in that power that I'm so energized that the word says, let us hold fast the profession. Let us hold fast the confession. Let us hold fast to that first confidence. You remember how it says there in Hebrews 10 on the last part of the chapter? It says, cast not away your confidence, for it has great recompense or reward. Some of you suffered to the taking away of your homes, your houses, and so forth. But let faith remain. Faith is still what's going to give you your reward, Paul said. Faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. Persistence is that third and final thing. Continuing persistence in the face of all things. That's that third way that we exercise ourselves unto purity. That's a pure in heart. Blessed are the pure in heart. Now, well, that isn't just a natural phenomenon. It's not just something randomly splattered around. It's something that's incorporated on purpose. Hebrews 10, 19 through 23, with Numbers 19 and 20. Numbers 19 and 19 and 20 are so poignant. They so speak to this dynamic that I'm speaking to you of right now, and it is the red heifer. And that puzzle of what the red heifer is. The red heifer is the Lord. And the red heifer understanding is, but the man that shall be unclean and shall not purify himself, that soul shall be cut off from among the congregation. Because he has defiled the sanctuary of the Lord. Brothers and sisters, if you can't see the New Covenant import of that, you just haven't been around here long enough. You're cutting yourself off because you refuse to take sprinkle of that. It's a red heifer is what he's speaking about. You won't partake of it, but yet you want to present yourself before the Lord. And you can't present yourself before the Lord before you have been purified by the red heifer ashes. And if you do, and you try to, then you'll be cut off from the sanctuary. You'll be cut off from the heavenly inheritance. You won't have access. You will not go in there without a pure heart. And you won't have a pure heart unless you exercise this sprinkling of your own conscience with the blood of the Christ and listening and having a purging done through that conscience of that evil and a carnality that's in you and putting on by the power of the Spirit the nature of Christ. Kindness, gentleness, meekness, mercy, forgiveness. That's putting on. Putting off is that stuff you know about real well. Putting on is the other side of that, right? I'm taking this off, but I'm putting this on. I'm not going to put that back on, nor am I going to... Oh, whoops, I got something on this. I need something. I need something to help me clean this up, will you? There's this mind when you're fishing down on the coast, you got to be careful because there's a lot of big birds flying over your head. You can't enter in. You can't qualify. The Lord is speaking here in these chapters about qualifying, and you're not going to qualify without a purity of heart. Blessed, for they will see God as the... And I won't be looking through binoculars. If you're pure heart, you're going to have close proximity. They will see God. That implies they'll be close to God. Pure heart speaks to access to God, close proximity. It's not speaking of eternal life here. It's talking about reward. Who shall ascend into the hill of the Lord? The psalmist asked that question. Who will go up, ascend? Or who shall stand in his holy place? He that hath clean hands and a pure heart. Who hath not lifted up his soul unto vanity, hasn't believed lies and forsaken his own mercy, nor sworn deceitfully. I don't need God. I don't need this stuff. I've got it all. He shall receive the blessing from the Lord and righteousness from God of his salvation. Isn't that what the Lord said? Blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall see God. What a promise. Progression. Cleansing in these ways. It started with a poor heart, a poor soul. But now it's progressed to where it is that you are pure of heart. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called the children of God. In the Greek, that's sons of God. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called the sons of God. The term son of God in Scripture always denotes maturity in a Christian. Children of God are not necessarily mature. But sons of God are always mature. All born again are children. Romans 8. But only mature ones does he address as sons. The novice or immature child is not fitted to be a peacemaker. You won't be fitted in this life. You wouldn't be sent out by the church to make peace if you weren't mature. You wouldn't be sent by this congregation out to make peace if you weren't mature. I wouldn't send you out. And God's not going to send you out. And Christ is not going to elevate you into being a peacemaker. You're not going to rule. You can't rule. You never were qualified. You were immature. You never grew. Peacemakers are mediators. Aren't they? You don't send a mediator out to make peace. I'm not going to send a novice or somebody, a child. I'm going to send somebody mature that knows what's going on. Peacemakers are mediators. They're priests. You're called to be a priest. You're called to be a mediator between the earth and the heavens, between man and God. You're called to be one. A mediator, a priest, a peacemaker between God and man. And you're to rule and reign. And how are you to rule and reign if you can't even bring peace in your own family? You don't even know how to say you're sorry or reconcile in your own little environment or with your workmate or whoever. How is it you're going to now rule and reign and be a people? You think it's just going to drop on you? Well, there will be an glory and filling, an incapacitating and an anointing. But it's only to those that have exercised in the minor, in the small things, that will be elevated in to the bigger things. You were worthy. You were worthy over a little. You were a good ruler over a little. Here's much. Priest-like, knowing and known by the Father. Son is different from children. The millennial kingdom of Christ will be made up of sons of God. Those found worthy to be peacemakers and to rule and reign with Jesus Christ. And then I say, the next thing is, blessed are they that are persecuted for righteousness' sake, for theirs is the kingdom of heavens. The promise, is this the last page, I hope? Yeah. The promise of blessing is not eternal life, for that has already been attained by these he addresses, but a reward in a place in his kingdom of the heavens, just above the earth, when he returns to rule on and over the earth for 1,000 years. Revelations 20, 4 through 6. We're to be joint heirs with Christ, if so be that we will suffer with him. Blessed be those who are persecuted for righteousness' sake, that we may be also glorified together. Without suffering, there won't be any glorifying. You aren't suffering because of righteousness' sake, there won't be any glorifying. Well, that's awful strong, Mike. Well, the Word says all those that want to be live as godly people will suffer persecution. Well, there you go. It's okay to say if you don't suffer, you won't rule, because it says all that want to be godly will suffer. So that just says if you haven't suffered, that just means you haven't been godly. Because if you're godly, you're going to suffer. The world hates you. It hated him. It's going to hate you. The world doesn't hate you, something wrong. If the world loves you, if you fit into the world, that's not a good thing. Romans 8:17 says, that is Romans 18, that is, you have to suffer with him to be glorified with him. And then the other scripture in 2 Timothy 3:12 says, yea, and all that will live godly in Christ Jesus shall suffer persecution. The reality is this: the world hated Christ Jesus. He had declared that the world would hate his followers. If we are Christ-like, the world will hate us. The simple fact is, if we choose not to be hated and suffer in this world, we may have our life here, but it will be a price of losing the life promised in the kingdom of heavens. If we suffer, we shall also reign with him. If we deny him, he also will deny us. That's the scripture Curtis read. At the judgment seat, and will lose the great blessing of Matthew 5, the kingdom of heavens. Changing his headdress in general, blessed are they, he now speaks directly to his disciples before him, and he says, blessed are you when men shall revile you. See, this is a progression in the blessings. You have went from born again now to Christ saying, blessed are you, you guys, you disciples, you that have grown and you that have matured. Blessed are you when men shall revile you and persecute you and shall say all manner of evil against you falsely for my sake. You're living a life for his sake, and they can see it. Rejoice and be exceedingly glad, for great is your reward in heaven. For heavens, for so persecuted they the prophets which were before you. Here's that comparison. The progression of spirituality is evidenced now in the personal ministry of those Christ-like. Ministers who for his sake now give their lives purposely. These he compares with prophets before. These he is more intimately revealed in. Those that have been sown into, who now are sown into the world. Matthew 13, 23, 37, and 38. Wise ministers in this last days of apostasy should rejoice and be exceedingly glad when they are persecuted for their faithfulness to the word. Acts 5:41 with 1 Peter 2:21. Praise the Lord. Amen. That's enough. A little bit too much. Thank you for your coming. Thank you for your participation. I pray the Lord will do a work. He'll do a work in all of us, and that he'll let this word come forth. It won't be sown in vain, but he'll water it, he'll bring it up, and it'll produce a crop for him, and he'll be proud of us. He'll be proud of us, and he'll know us by our names. That's my prayer. Bless us, little group, this Saturday afternoon, Father. Bless us. Bless their diligence in coming and listening and participating and bearing the seats, hard seats. And I ask you to bless them, Lord. You said, blessed are, blessed are, blessed are. Could we have a blessed are those that come to this Torah meeting? Could we have that, Lord? Blessed are those that come to gather around your word and hear it, and not only hear it, but incorporate it in their lives. Blessed are these who have laid out their hearts and bare them before us today, and those that have repented and confessed their sins, their weakness, and they've asked for strength and prayer and help, and were real and practical and cried out to you for help, Lord. Blessed are those today who have heard and incorporated this word in their hearts. Blessed because you've forgiven, you've washed, you've cleansed, you've reestablished, you've anointed, you set us on a path that we can be fruitful. I bless you. I praise you. I worship you. I thank you, Lord. With all my heart, I give you thanks. Thanks for that just simple prayers can reach all the way up into your very presence. Just go right up in there. That's amazing that you've allowed us to do that. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name we pray. Jerry, would you sing?